attention to them. Allah, our God, is the greatest. The one and only glory to Him. He wanted humans to be the best and give His best religion to them.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And welcome to an episode number 166 in the series of Gardens of the Pious. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Ameen. Wal'aqibatu lil-muttaqeen. Wala'udwana illa ala al-zalimeen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidi al-awwalina wal-akhirina nabiyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wa ba'd, brothers and sisters, inshaAllah, today we'll continue with chapter number 40. And that is the third episode in explaining the chapter of Birru al-Walidaini, or Salatu al-Arham, the kind treatment towards the parents, and establishment of the ties of blood relationship. The last ayah we have of all the ayat that Al-Imam al-Nawawi listed in the beginning of the chapter is number 14 of Surah Luqman, in which Allah the Almighty says, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ وَفِصَالُهُ فِي عَامَيْنِ أَنِ اشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيْكَ إِلَيَّ الْمَصِيرُ. And this ayah means Allah the Almighty using the royal we, saying, we have enjoined on man to be good and dutiful to his parents, بِوَالِدَيْهِ. His mother bore him in weakness and hardship upon weakness and hardship. That is the meaning of the word وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ. وَفِصَالُهُ فِي عَامَيْنِ. And his weaning is in 2 years. أَنْ يَشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيْكَ. That's a command from Allah. Give thanks to me and to your parents. إِلَيَّ الْمَصِيرِ. Unto me is the final destination. In Surah Al-Ahqaf, in ayah number 15, Allah the Almighty says, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. In Surah Luqman, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ. Then he further starts explaining the reason, especially with regards to the mother, because she bore him in weakness upon weakness. وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنًا. While in Surah Al-Ahqaf, Allah the Almighty says, حَمَلَتْهُ. She bore him كُرْهًا. وَوَضَعَتْهُ كُرْهًا. His mother did bear him with trouble. She had trouble while bearing him and hardship. And with trouble she brought him forth. So here he used the term كُرْهًا. وَوَضَعَتْهُ كُرْهًا. And in the ayah of Surah Luqman, he says, حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنًا. And also, in Surah Al-Ahqaf, Allah the Almighty says, وَحَمْلُهُ وَفِصَالُهُ ثَلَاثُونَ شَهْرًا. The bearing period of the child, the pregnancy, and al-fisal altogether, which is the weaning, altogether 30 months. ثَلَاثُونَ شَهْرًا. While the ayah of Surah Luqman, ayah number 14, Allah the Almighty says, وَفِصَالُهُ فِي عَامَيْنِ. And his weaning is in 2 years. His weaning is 2 years is recommended because Allah the Almighty says in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَالْوَالِدَاتُ يُرْضِعْنَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ حَوْلَيْنِ كَامِلَيْنِ. Then he said, لِمَنْ أَرَادَ أَنْ يُتِمَّ الرَّضَاعَ. Mothers should suckle their babies for 2 complete years. لِمَنْ أَرَادَ أَنْ يُتِمَّ الرَّضَاعَ. If the mother wants to complete the course, which is 2 lunar years. 12 months and 12 months, that's 24 months. So 24 months, and while in the ayah of Surah Luqman, if Surah Fussilat, Allah the Almighty says, حَمْلُهُ وَفِصَالُهُ ثَلَاثُونَ شَهْرًا. So the pregnancy, along with the weaning within 2 years, that's 24 months of 2 years. Then in Surah Luqman, Allah the Almighty says, وَفِصَالُهُ فِي عَمَيْن. So 30 months, the ayah of Surah Al-Ahqaf, the pregnancy and the weaning all together. وَحَمْلُهُ وَفِصَالُهُ ثَلَاثُونَ شَهْرًا. You deduct out of that the weaning or the breastfeeding period, which is 2 years, 24 months, remains for us 6. 30 minus 24 remains for us 6, which refers to 6 months is the minimum pregnancy period. Why are we doing this calculation and linking between the ayah of Surah Luqman and the ayah of Surah Al-Ahqaf? Simply because it happened once. Somebody got married, newly married, and then his wife got pregnant. Congratulations and good news, and everybody's happy. In the past, they didn't have pregnancy test. But it would only show. And whenever the period is interrupted, and she doesn't have the period for a couple months, that's a sign that she is pregnant. But the problem was, whenever she gave birth to a child at the after 6 months of pregnancy, after 6 months of pregnancy. So when the husband complained that, I doubt that my wife have this son from me because we're only married for 6 months. How could she give birth only after 6 months? So he suspected that she may had a relationship before marriage, which allowed a period of 9 months to give birth. Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib looked into the case. This incident happened during the era of Uthman ibn Affan. And he said, that is possible. How could it be possible? He said, didn't Allah say, وَفِصَالُهُ فِي عَامَيْن, in the ayah of Surah Luqman, and the weaning is within 2 years, 24 months, yes. And in the ayah of Surah Fussilat, وَحَمْلُهُ وَفِصَالُهُ ثَلَاثُونَ شَهْرًا, the ayah of Surah Al-Ahqaf, حَمْلُهُ وَفِصَالُهُ ثَلَاثُونَ شَهْرًا, ayah number 15 of Surah Al-Ahqaf. So that means the pregnancy and the weaning all together 30 months. So it remains for us 6 months for pregnancy. This is what the Quran says. وَهَذَا أَقَلُّ الْحَمْلِ. That is the least period of pregnancy. Which means she's innocent because it is possible that a wife would only bear a child for 6 months and she would give a normal delivery. This is what the Quran says. Look at the scholars, the two scholars, when they read the Quran with understanding, comprehension. مَن يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. So they link between the ayat and they understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. Like when the companions were very worried that Allah the Almighty says, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. The ayah of Surah Al-An'am. Only those who accepted faith, they believed in Allah, وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ, and they did not interrupt their faith, contaminate their faith with any ظُلْم. الظُلْم means generally wrongdoing. Such people shall be secure on the Day of Judgment, and such are the truly guided ones. So the Sahaba went to the Prophet ﷺ and said, Ya Rasulallah, as human beings we all commit sins. We're believers, but we all commit sins. Does it mean that we will not receive security on the Day of Judgment? Because the ayah says, لَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ. They did not mess up their iman with any dhulm. He said, no, this is not the regular dhulm. Rather, it refers to the dhulm which is mentioned in Surah Luqman. When Luqman was given an advice to his son, and he said, يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. Oh, my dear son, beware of shirk. Do not commit shirk. Do not set partners to Allah in worship, because setting partners to Allah in worship, a shirk, is a great ظُلْم. So this is the kind of ظُلْم which Allah was referring to in the other ayah of Surah Al-An'am. Al-Qur'an yufassiru ba'duhu ba'da. The Qur'an explains itself. So some ayat here explain another ayah which is not clear to some in another chapter, and so on. So we understand from these two ayat, ayah number 14 of Surah Luqman and ayah number 15 of Surah Al-Ahqaf, the meaning of the period for pregnancy, the minimum, the period of breastfeeding, and all together. And when Allah the Almighty used the term حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ, his mother bore him in weakness upon weakness. The first weakness is because the woman's structure is normally weaker than a man. The norms is to see men muscular, okay, bodybuilders, pushing trucks, carrying heavy loads and lifting weight, and women are delicate, soft, you know, slim. Nowadays, of course, you see that women are competing with men in lifting weight and growing muscles, but I'm talking about the norms though. So the structure of a woman is normally weaker than the structure of a man. That's a wahn by itself. And that's why it is not even logical to see a man fighting against a woman, a man wrestling against a woman, because normally a man is more powerful than a woman and his structure is more powerful than a woman. It is not befitting for a man to fight in public or even wrestle against a woman. This is not normal. So this is the first wahn, the physical structure of a woman. But Allah has prepared her in this fashion to be perfect mother, to suit her job as a mother. Normally, if the children or any of them misbehaves at home, what does the mother do? Says, I'm going to tell on you. Tell whom? I'm going to tell your daddy. He's the one who does the punishment part. So she scares him off of the daddy. What is the second wahn? The second wahn, second weakness, is while she's pregnant. Now she's not alone. Once the pregnancy test is positive, and everybody celebrates and everybody is happy, that especially if it is the first child, you got to be very careful. You sleep this way, you lie down this way, you eat this, you don't eat that, you don't take any medication. Why? Because you're pregnant and that affects the fetus and it can cause a great harm to the fetus. You have to be very careful. How long does this process take? This is not just a couple weeks, 9 months. And the minimum, as Allah the Almighty referred to in the ayat, is 6 months. That's plenty of time. حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ كُرْهًا وَوَضَعَتْهُ كُرْهًا. There is a dialect which says كَرْهًا with a fatha. وَوَضَعَتْهُ كَرْهًا. With trouble she bore him, and with trouble she brought him forth. Then, whenever the period is complete in the womb, and the mother is ready to deliver the baby, that's another hassle. That's another difficulty and hardship. وَوَضَعَتْهُ كُرْهًا. Giving birth and the labor pain, the birth pain, is something that Allah the Almighty, even though the woman is very weak, but He made her capable to bear that pain because she's receiving her own baby. So Allah is reminding you with this whole cycle, remember what your mother went through? How dare you speak to her in disrespect, or you shout at her, or raise your voice before her? Why did Allah the Almighty mention the mother? And, in other ayat, Allah spoke about the parents. بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. Then He put emphasis on the mother in a couple ayat. And in many hadith, as we will be studying, that the mother, the mother, the mother. When the parents get old, the mother is weaker than the father who has been working, earning, saving, could even take another job, undertake another business. But the mother has only her husband whenever she was a house engineer, raising the children. And as she grew old, she has only her children. So the children should stand up for their responsibility and understand that this is not a favor that they are doing her. this is paying back some of her rights. When I say some, because in the Athar, as I said in a couple episodes ago, when Abdullah ibn Umar saw a man carrying his mother on his shoulders while performing tawaf, and he was proud of himself, and he believed that I'm being dutiful to her enough. Abdullah ibn Umar said to him, whatever you do, this is not even equivalent to a single scream, that cram which led her to scream while giving birth. It's a very severe pain. وَوَضَعَتْهُ كُرْهَا وَهْنًا عَلَى وَهْنٍ, weakness upon weakness. And with trouble she delivered him, or she brought him forth. That's not even equivalent to a single scream that she had to shout when she was given birth. Subhanallah. أَنِشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيْكَ. You have to be grateful to me, and you have to be grateful to your parents. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ لَا يَشْكُرِ النَّاسِ لَا يَشْكُرِ اللَّهِ. If you're not grateful to people for assisting you, for guiding you, for helping you, for doing a favor to you, you're not grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Being grateful to people, whether those people are good or bad, believers or non-believers, whosoever does you a favor, say thank you. Compensate him. Reward him. If you don't have any of the means to reward him enough, simply say, Jazakallahu khayran. May Allah bless you with goodness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses whichever reward to deliver to this person who did you a favor. إِلَيَّ الْمَصِيرِ. Remember that unto me is the final destination. So if you behave, if you're kind to your parents, if you're dutiful to them, you'll be happy with this destination. And if you're not, you better get ready for the consequences. What kind of consequences, and how dutiful we should be to the parents or to any form, whenever any form is living? Now the hadith will explain what was mentioned in the Quran as a whole or general. Will specify what kind of rights that the parents have upon us. How should we treat them? Those rights are not listed like 1, 2, 3, 4, and that's it. But they also undergo the cultural practices. In some cultures, and in some societies, and depending on the financial capacity of the families, if the parents are well off, and they have their own house, and they have a maid, and you're living in a separate place, no problem. You visit them every once in a while, you know, as much as you can, check on them, see if they need anything, speak to them kindly, be obedient to them. Much lesser duty than if the parents are broke. They don't have any saving because they spend everything on you to raise you, to make you a successful doctor, engineer, lawyer, or teacher, or whatever. Now it is your duty to start taking care of them. They don't have a place to live in. They would live with me in my flat, in my house. My wife is not too happy with that. Why? From the beginning, I discuss with my future spouse, this is my condition. I'm the only son, and my mother is and has been a single parent, and she raised me. She has no one to look after her, and she will have to stay with me in the flat. Are you okay with that? Yes. Will you help me to take care of her? Yes. But not because your wife is not happy with that. She has a right to have her own house and all of that. But it doesn't mean that you throw your mother in a nursing home or put her with another relative if you are the only person who is supposed to look after her. There are some cases like that. So it varies from a case to another, from a culture to another. But we do not consider nor have in mind the non-Muslim cultures where the parents literally suffer when they grow old because the children live their own lives and they barely check on them by the phone. We don't say this is cultural and I'm doing like everybody else. That is not even considered. That is dismissed. The rights are much greater than that in their lives and even after they pass away. Let me begin right away with the first hadith in the chapter, chapter number 40 of Birru al-Walidayn wa Silatul Arham, to see what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam means by Birru al-Walidayn and so on. Hadith number 312. عن أبي عبد الرحمن عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه قال سألت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أي العمل أحب إلى الله تعالى؟ قال الصلاة على وقتها. قلت ثم أي؟ قال بر الوالدين. قلت ثم أي؟ قال الجهاد في سبيل الله. متفق عليه. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, may Allah be pleased with him, said, I once asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which deed is loved most by Allah the Almighty? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam answered saying, الصلاة على وقتها, to offer the salah at its proper time. I asked, what is next? He replied, صلى الله عليه وسلم, being kind to your parents. Then I asked, what is next? He replied, صلى الله عليه وسلم, jihad in the way of Allah. In fact, when we look into this hadith, we recognize the meaning of each segment of it. To offer the prayer when it's time, to be good and useful to the parents, then al-jihadu fi sabilillah. What is interesting in this hadith is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam considered birru al-walidain superior to al-jihadu fi sabilillah. To be continued after the short break, inshallah, please stay tuned. رسول الله حبيب الله رسول حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome back. In this hadith which we shared with you before the break, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam which deed is loved most by Allah. He said to offer the prayer when it's time. He said then what is next? He said to be good to your parents. He said what is next? He said to observe jihad in the way of Allah. We said what is interesting in this hadith, how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam considered birru al-walidain superior to observing jihad in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Birru al-walidain was put in order next to the command of believing in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how significant it is. Some people think that if I go to observe jihad, it will wipe out all my sins, including how rude I used to be to my parents. It's a matter of skipping your duties. That's why when Abdullah ibn Abd al-As narrated in the sound hadith, a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, I want to give you the Pledge of Allegiance to make hijrah and observe jihad for the sake of Allah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, أَحَيٌّ وَلِدَاكَ, are your parents still alive? He said, yes. He said, go back, فَأَحْسِن صُحْبَتَهُمَا, and be kind to them, give them a good company. This is jihad. In another narration, when he asked him, أَحَيٌّ وَلِدَاكَ, he said, yes, both of them are still living. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, go back, فَفِيهِمَا فَجَاهِدْ, you know, observe jihad. Or jihad is to be dutiful to them. You can observe jihad via serving them, by obeying them. This is general. Is this general with all types of jihad? This is when the jihad is fardu kifaya. When joining the Muslim army is optional. But when joining the army and fighting against the enemies is the duty of every single Muslim, man and woman, young and old, you don't need permission from no one. You cannot stay behind and say, because, you know, it is better for me to work and feed the poor or work and be good to my parents, because now it becomes fardu ayn. But in regular conditions, where it was not needed, alhamdulillah, we have enough soldiers. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to this man, ارجع إليهما فأحسن صحبتهما, return back to your parents, serve them properly, be kind to them, be good to them, give them a good company. ففيهما فجاهد, and observe jihad through serving your parents. That shows us, number one, the significance of being good and dutiful to the parents. And it is even superior to observing jihad whenever it is fardu kifaya. The following hadith is hadith number 313 in the Blessed Series of Guardians of the Pious. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يجزي ولد والدا إلا أن يجده مملوكا فيشتريه فيعتقه. The hadith is collected by Imam Muslim, and it means that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, no son can repay the kind treatment that was showed to him by his father unless he finds him a slave and buys him, and then he frees him from slavery. The hadith is collected by Imam Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam means in this hadith that basically you can never do enough to pay back your parents, to pay back your father. Only in one condition: if your father happened to be a slave, not a slave of yours, of course, a slave owned by another master, whenever slavery was still effective, then you work hard and you strive throughout your entire life, not to save for your own self or to get married or for your children, rather to ransom your father and to free him. So no matter what you do, it will not be enough to compensate your father or your mother for what they have done to you to bring you up or to raise you. The following hadith is hadith number 314. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليكرم ضيفة ومن كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليصل رحمة ومن كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليقل خيرا أو ليصمت. متفق عليه. Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, he who believes in Allah and the last day, let him be hospitable to his guest. And he who believes in Allah and the last day, let him maintain the good ties or good the ties of blood relationship. And he who believes in Allah and the last day must be good or remain silent. The hadith is agreed upon its authenticity, collected by both al-Bukhari and Muslim. If you remember, we studied a similar hadith with a slight change in one of the qualities. The hadith was discussed in the previous chapter, the rights of the neighbors, in which the Prophet ﷺ mentioned the qualities of being hospitable to the guest and honoring the neighbors, then saying what is good or be quiet. While in this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ utilized the quality of faith, belief in Allah, belief in the last day. And we mentioned, while explaining this hadith in the previous chapter, the reason why Allah and why the Prophet ﷺ normally used belief in Allah and the last day together to urge the believers to do or to abstain from doing something that is forbidden. So here he says, وَمَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيَصِلْ رَحِمَهِ. If you truly believe in Allah and the last day, then uphold the ties of your kinship. Maintain good the ties of the blood relationship. This is a religious duty. This is a right that you owe to Allah and you owe to your relatives. And on top of the list, obviously, one's parents. Then the relatives include the brothers and the sisters, the uncles and the aunts, paternal and maternal, the nephews and nieces. It could be if everybody is not in need for any financial help, then by exchanging visits, by praying for them. If any of them is sick, you visit them and you attend their good moments, you share with them. and you share with them the sorrow and grief, and you exchange gifts with them. So these are the qualities of Silatul Rahim and what you need to do in order to uphold those ties. In the other hadith, he was talking about being good to the neighbors. And the Prophet ﷺ in this hadith listed the previous two qualities, which is being hospitable to the guest and saying what is good or be quiet. So Silatul Rahim, upholding the ties of your kin and being dutiful to your parents as on top of the list, is a sign of belief in Allah and a sign of belief in the hereafter, that you will be asked about that. You will be held accountable for how you treated your parents. And that urges a person to watch his actions and his sayings and whether he is fulfilling those rights or not towards the relatives, towards the parents, towards their guests, towards the neighbors. The following hadith is hadith number 315. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله تعالى خلق الخلق حتى إذا فرغ منهم قامت الرحم فقالت هذا مقام العائذ بك من القطيعة قال نعم أما ترضين أن أصل من وصلك وأقطع من قطعك قالت بلى قال فذلك لك ثم قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم اقرأوا إن شئتم فهل عسيتم إن توليتم أن تفسدوا في الأرض وتقطعوا أرحامكم أولئك الذين لعنهم الله فأصمهم وأعمى أبصرهم آيات سورة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. The hadith is agreed upon its authenticity. In another narration collected by Imam Bukhari, فقال الله تعالى من وصلك وصلته ومن قطعك قطعته. Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that the Prophet of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Allah created the creatures, and when he finished the task of his creation, Ar-Rahim, the word Ar-Rahim refers to the ties of relationship. And we said also the word Ar-Rahim in Arabic refers to the womb, which conceals the fetus, protects the fetus until it grows up and is ready to be delivered. So, but in this segment and in this context, it refers to the ties of kinship. So we're talking about Silatul Rahim, or upholding the ties of kinship. Ar-Rahim said, O Allah, at this place I seek refuge with you against severing my ties. Allah the Almighty said that I treat with kindness those who treat you with kindness, and I sever ties with you with I sever ties with those who sever ties with you. It said, who said Ar-Rahim, the ties of relationship, said to Allah, I'm satisfied then. Allah the Almighty then said, then this is yours. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, recite this ayah if you like. Actually, two ayat of Surah Muhammad, peace be upon him, number 22 and number 23, which we studied thoroughly in the program of correct recitation in their tafsir. فَهَلْ عَسَيْتُمْ إِن تَوَلَّيْتُمْ أَن تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَتُقَطِّعُوا أَرْحَامَكُمْ أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ لَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهُ فَأَصَمَّهُمْ وَأَعْمَى أَبْصَرَهُمْ. The meaning of these two ayat, that Allah the Almighty says what it means. Would you then, if you are given the authority, and by the way, it also have another meaning depending on the interpretation, if you turn away from Islam, do mischief in the land, and sever your ties of kinship, such are they whom Allah has cursed, so that He has made them deaf and blinded their sights. Al-Imam al-Bukhari, may Allah have mercy on him, in his collection listed the hadith with different words. When he said, according to the words of Al-Imam al-Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah the Almighty says, he who maintains good ties with you, I maintain good ties with him. and he who severs your ties, I sever ties with him. What does this hadith say? The hadith shows the significance and the importance of upholding the ties of kinship. And this is pretty old, since the beginning of the creation, when Allah خلق الخلق, created the creatures. Ar-Rahim, in whichever form or shape that Allah the Almighty wills and desires, was presented and asked Allah the Almighty, begging Allah the Almighty to give it a special status. مقام العائد بك من القطيعة. I seek refuge with you against severing me. So this rahim is the tie of every living human being to his family members, to his relatives. Sought refuge with Allah against being severed. So Allah the Almighty addressed Ar-Rahim, answering Ar-Rahim by saying, wouldn't it be pleasing to you to know that I shall uphold and connect everyone who would uphold you and connect you, and I shall sever everyone who severs you. So the compensation is depending on how you treat Ar-Rahim. If you uphold the ties of your kinship, if you go to your relatives, then Allah the Almighty will join you to him, will connect you to him, will bless you. And this blessing is not only in the hereafter. There is no other obedience which deserves an immediate reward in this dunya before the hereafter more than Silatul Rahim, or upholding the ties of kinship. This is since the beginning of the creation. Allah the Almighty promised the ties of Ar-Rahim to join, to connect and uphold those who would uphold the ties of their kinship, and to sever and to disconnect one who would sever the ties to his kinship. It is not optional, brothers and sisters, nor is it mere recommended. It's obligatory. Just imagine for how many months we haven't talked to, visited, or inquired about immediate relatives, brothers and sisters who are not talking to each other, cousins who do not even phone each other, not even in Eids, not in Ramadan, no exchanging visitations. The society has become so materialistic that everyone is sucked in their business, in their schools, in their affairs. But if you were to know that, wallahi, upholding the ties of kinship, making a special effort to visit your relatives, uncles and aunts, nephews and nieces, brothers and sisters, and taking gifts to them, guarantees an increase in your provision, a barakah in your lifetime, a barakah in your work, a blessing in your job, a blessing in your earning, a blessing in your provision, and an extension in your lifespan, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the Sahih Hadith. But people are working hard and forgetting and neglecting these values. Neighbors aren't talking to their neighbors. They do not check on them. They do not ask if they need anything. They do not, you know, sometimes the neighbors have a death case, and their next door neighbors would not bother to give them the condolence because they don't want to initiate any conversation. In a materialistic society, everyone wants to live for themselves. So their children grow up the same way. They hide and they conceal all their successes, and they don't want to share anything with others. Accordingly, whenever they are in suffering or in sorrow moments, nobody shares with them their pain. Nobody condoles them. Nobody exchanges visits with them. Has become a very selfish society, selfish kind of life. And this kind of life is sickening. And it is void of any blessing, and it is void of any success. This is in the hadith. أَلَا تَرْضَيْنَ أَنْ أَصِلَ مَنْ وَصَلَكِ وَأَنْ أَقْطَعَ مَنْ قَطَعَكِ. Wouldn't you be pleased if I connect and uphold those who uphold your ties? I treat those who uphold the ties of their kinship with the same. I bless them. I bring them near to me. I forgive them their sins. I increase their provision. I give them barakah in their lifespan, as explained in other hadith. Versus the one who severs his relationship to his family members, Allah the Almighty will sever him. Allah the Almighty may even suspend the reward for other good deeds that he have done, because he is severing the ties of his kinship and deprive him from blessings because he is قَاطِعُ الرَّحِمِ. And also severing the relationship deserves an immediate punishment in addition to the awaiting punishment in the hereafter. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then recited ayah number 22 and ayah number 23 of Surah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَهَلْ عَسَيْتُمْ إِن تَوَلَّيْتُمْ. As you know that the previous ayat were talking about the mandate of observing jihad to defend your deen, your belief and the believers. So some of the munafiqeen, some of those who are hypocrites, did not like this command because they wanted to rest in peace and do not do anything. So Allah the Almighty reminded them with their condition before Islam, when they severed their relations with their rahim, their family members, when they attacked each other over a little sheep or a camel, when they fought against each other, when they buried their own children alive, their daughters, out of fear of poverty. Islam eliminated all these ill behaviors and acts of jahiliyyah and taught them otherwise. So if you turn away from the deen, you're going to go back to the old jahiliyyah traditions. And tufsidu fil ardi, you spread on earth and you corrupt on earth and you spread corruption and mischief on earth. وَتُقَطِّعُوا أَرْحَامَكُمْ. Not just تَقْطَعُوا أَرْحَامَكُمْ, that's an extensive form. You sever your relations with all your family members. So this is such a great sin and a great evil deed. وَتُقَطِّعُوا أَرْحَامَكُمْ, which deserves the following punishment. The ayah says, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ لَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهُ فَأَصَمَّهُمْ وَأَعْمَى أَبْصَارَهُمْ. Such people are those whom Allah the Almighty caused their ears to be deaf and their eyes to be blind. فَأَصَمَّهُمْ وَأَعْمَى أَبْصَارَهُمْ, because he cursed them. وَاللَّعْنُ الطَّرْدُ مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Allah cursed them, يعني he expelled them from his mercy. They are not eligible for his mercy. Why? Because of their ill behavior. They sever their relations with their family members. They spread corruption and mischief on earth simply because of not following the teachings of the deen. فَهَلْ عَسَيْتُمْ إِن تَوَلَّيْتُمْ أَن تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَتُقَطِّعُوا أَرْحَمَكُمْ. The word تَقْطِيع is cutting repeatedly over and over and over, severing the relations with everyone else, because this is the quality of the non-believers. They do not uphold the ties of kinship. Only whenever there is a benefit. Imagine if a non-believer once visits his cousin and on the happy occasion takes them some gifts, then he does it one more time and the cousin or the brother does not do the same to him, he will quit visiting him. He will quit giving him gifts, because this is how it is. I pay you, you pay me. I scratch your back, you scratch my back. But it doesn't say like that in Islam. It says that you should uphold the ties of your kinship even if they still sever it, even if they do not do the same to you. You're expecting the reward from Allah, not from others, even those whom you're doing good to them. In the narration of Imam Bukhari said, مَنْ وَصَلَكِ وَصَلْتُ وَمَنْ قَطَعَكِ قَطَعْتُ. It's as simple as that. Whoever upholds his ties, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will connect him to him, will bless him, will bless his provision, his family, his rizq, his lifespan. And who severs his relations with his family, he will be severed from every blessing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us our sins, guide us to what is best, protect us, and make us wasili ar-rahim. Uphold the ties of our kinship, visit our relatives, pray for them, share with them their happy moments as well as their sorrow and grief. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from all of us. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. And until next episode, I leave you all in the care of Allah. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله. Allah our God is the greatest, one and only glory to him. He born in humans to be the best.
and give his best religion to them.
Allah, our God, is the greatest, the one and only glory to him. He born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them.
So why did they ignore that, forgetting all about hell and paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price?
So why did they ignore that, forgetting all about hell and paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price?
Rasulullah.